have the book right here. This is the book. It's a tome. She basically goes through every little thing in the huge energy structure of our body. So it's really worthwhile looking at. And so she's a paradigm shifting new thought leader and an international teacher and speaker. She spent the last 45 years developing this system. You know, she's seen this since she was like a little girl. She's seen this energy structure. So, and she teaches a modality called core individuation. But I don't think you have to be a core individuation practitioner. You can take some of her knowledge and apply it to your practice. It basically, core individuation addresses healing the entire energy structure. But I think with our modality and core individuation, they get at different things and they work very complementary. So she's worked with thousands of people over the last 30 years. She spoke at UCSF, and I think you spoke at Kaiser too?
Yeah, yeah. Kaiser Permanente.
Yeah, and
that's right.
So she's a pioneer in blending the worlds of energy healing and allopathic medicine. And so Jane also has experience with Desda.
Yeah, I've taken some of the classes. Well, it just changed everything. After we met her at the with Yvonne, and she came and talked, and then it just was like a tumble, really, of things. It helped in lots of ways that I took the class, and using the Sharin, it's really interesting in that it's more effortless. There's really this sense of it just kind of flowing, and a lot more intuition coming into it, and feeling much more grounded with it, and my electrical sensitivity has really gone down enormously, even though it's a challenge here. But I just want to suggest you try it out and feel it out and get present with Desda.
Wonderful. Well, I'm so glad to be here, and I've been looking forward to talking to the Biophoton community again. I had an opportunity to meet you guys a while back, and as a result, the core individuation and biophoton communities have been cross-pollinating. We're having a little bit of a love affair, so if you're not in on it, you might want to get in on it, because I've trained quite a number of practitioners, and so all my practitioners are getting biophoton, and all the biophoton people are getting CI, and everybody's cross-pollinating, and that's what we want. We want that in the subtle energy working world, but we want that in alternative medicine and in integrative medicine. We want to experience things. So if you haven't had an acupuncture session, if you haven't done these things, it's great to get out and experience those kinds of wonderful things. So what I wanted to do is really aggressively state what I see as the issue that folks in the biophoton community are confronting. And I'd like to talk about preventing electromagnetic field merging by using your subtle anatomy. So there's a real issue here, and just to kind of get the issue on the table, how many of you are limited in how many clients you can see in a day? You know, like I can see two people and then I'm done, you know, toast afterwards. How many of you have had the experience of walking into a room and picking up the energy in the space and having it affect you? Feeling negative or upset or confused by it. How many of you forget what you're arguing about in the middle of the argument? One of the things that I'm doing is I'm just trying to bring forward things that we often think are our fault. I'm doing X wrong because I feel uncomfortable in places. And what I'm here to say is that there's nothing wrong with you, it's just your subtle anatomy. You're not broken. You're actually maybe ahead of the curve, because you're already feeling something that other people don't feel. So we all know what healing work requires. It requires talent, good training with ongoing ed, a quest for mastery, and most importantly, genuine curiosity. A desire to solve the puzzle, to get to the bottom go to the place where it all started, right? Isn't that what you guys are all doing? You're all puzzle solvers, right? So this is what makes you happy, fulfilled. I mean, if you're in the right place at the right time, that is, right, the thing that makes you happy. Fulfilled, and most of you truly love your work, don't you? You adore it. And the thing that stops you maybe from doing it just all the time is that you get tired. You get tired from doing it all the time. So it's not, dedication is not lacking. Enthusiasm for the process is not lacking. The healing journey isn't lacking because I know you're all doing your own work. You know, you're working your own way, you're lifting the weights, you're doing the thing that you need to do. You're delving into those childhood traumas and you're dismissing this and dismissing that, getting rid of your, you know, vaccinations and on, working through, getting rid of TB, you know, getting you and you're doing it and you're amazing. I love that. So, but underneath all of that is that search for wholeness, right? That's what you're after. I want to be whole. And not just me, but everybody I touch, everybody I work with, everybody that I share myself with. So it's the commitment to your calling that keeps you coming back for more and can push you beyond what you know is wise. For example, doing one more healing. Hi.
Hi.
Come on in. Taking one more call, you know, that one more call that comes, and I just, oh, she's had such a hard time. Okay, I'll answer, you know, one more call. Skipping meals, you know. One of my students has been single-handedly revolutionizing the hospice care movement in Massachusetts by simply suggesting that people eat their lunch. Caregivers eat their lunch. So there's, I mean, this is like something that healers do. We forget, well, okay, I can just eat a protein bar. You know, no, actually, that's not lunch. You forget to go on a vacation. Or maybe just go without one. I don't need one.
Feel I'm guilty on one.
Or you're on the vacation and you end up healing the hotel staff. Seriously, are you guilty of that? I know. Hey, you know, I know what I'm talking about here. And you know what you do, right? So not everyone pushes it. You know, some people are wise and sensible and reasonable and take care of themselves and do all the right things and check, check, check. They've marked up all the boxes. But if you've ever experienced burnout or compassion fatigue, you know about compassion fatigue, right? Exhaustion and surprising limits on your ability to keep working, you know it costs you dearly, both financially and physically, right? So do you pick up symptoms from your clients? Do you ever have an experience of picking up their nausea, or if they're in chemo, you feel a burning sensation in your the center of your body, or, you know, right? Some of you do. Some of you know what I'm talking about. In fact, who doesn't know what I'm talking about? Good. So then you're really familiar with the concept of merging. Because that's what you're doing. You're merging with your clients. And what we found out with Biophoton folks is they were also merging with their machines. Ooh. Yummy. Merging with the machine. Now there you go. So they were merging with their machines, some of them. Some of them were merging with the entire room while they were merging with their machines and the client. And there was an experience that people were having of being totally affected by sort of the electromagnetic radiation of the space that they were in, or even the other person that they were with. And then, of course, by their own machines, which they weren't really aware that was happening. So I call this merging, and it's something that empathic, energetically sensitive people almost universally suffer from. And I made this a focus because this was me. All I had to do was walk by somebody with a cold and I would get it. I mean, that was the first 25 years of my life. Just walk by somebody and and I get a cold. It's way worse if they were having an emotional tantrum, you know, then I would get that. But the thing is, I always thought it was me. I always thought it was my immune system. I always thought it was my emotional instability. I always thought it was my problem, that I was broken. Have you had that thought about yourself? Like, maybe it's me? She says all the time, right? I guess what I'm here to tell you is that it doesn't necessarily mean that you're broken. Maybe I'm, okay, maybe. We're not going to rule it out altogether, but probably not. If you're here, you've probably done enough work to get here. So taking it on is not the cause. So the cause is not the taking on of it. The cause is not the merging. That's not the cause. It's an effect. And I discovered it was not knowing where I ended and began that was the issue. Not knowing where we end and begin. That's actually the issue that we're working with. And a quality of being unconscious. Not unconscious in a normal way, but unconscious of the subtle anatomy, unconscious of the subtle ending and beginning. So I realized merging was a manifestation of the way that my subtle self, or your subtle self, the subtle anatomy, and most specifically, the electromagnetic part of your subtle anatomy, absorb, connects with, pulls in, and merges with another person or a group of people. And this causes significant overwhelm, illness, depression, exhaustion, and all the wonderful symptoms that drew you to healing. You know? Well, maybe I'll figure it out this way. So I'll become a biophoton practitioner, and then I'll figure out what's going on with me. We often do that, right? Half the healers I know, and I teach healers all the time, half of them come in to a class because they want to be better at feeling who they are. They want to feel themselves in the room, in the healing, in the space, and they kind of started to lose it. After you've been doing healing work for 15 or 20 or 30 years, and I know some of, has anybody been doing biophoton that long? It's more recent, right? So you guys haven't hit the 20-year mark or whatever, but when you do hit that 20-year mark, there's an automaticness that's part of your reflect, you know? You just reflect the energy of the work that you do. And so at that point, you know, you're representing not just biophoton, but you're representing wholeness, vitality, health, well-being, competency, the capacity to be really an alive being. That's what you're doing. And if you are steadily losing that as you're giving away parts of yourself with the merging, what happens is that at a 20-year mark, you've got to retire. You can't keep going. I've heard it said that most body workers can't do more than 15 years. But that's really... And if you're a massage therapist, you know that around the year 15, your body starts to say, I can't do this anymore. Why? Why is that happening? Is it because the muscles are giving up? Probably not. So, the electromagnetic field is very interesting. So let's talk about the difference between the electromagnetic field and the subtle anatomy. Because this is the part, this is the place where it's really interesting. And we are going to do an exercise in a minute, so don't worry. You'll be doing stuff in a second. But the electromagnetic field is out about 3 to 4 feet. So just, you can feel that, right? You can feel that for yourself. Just right now, take your arms and stretch out and just feel your own electromagnetic field. And it's got a quality of slight buzz. You know, those of you that are palpators who really have heightened sensitivity and sensibility with your hands, it'll be easier for you. That's a good thing to do. Shake them out a little bit if you want to really experience this. But I teach what I call extragenic sensing skills, which is sensing the subtle energy before it's shifted and after it's shifted, what it feels like. So it's one of the things I do. So this is a beginning exercise. So we just feel our own sacred anatomy here. So we know that there's more to us than the physical body. We know that the energy that's being generated by the heart and the brain and the cells, that this energy is profound, that it's a gift, you know? And we create this field. Well, what we don't know, and what I begin to see, is that there are people that are actually pulling in from the electrical light socket and the unpleasant air conditioning unit, that are pulling in the electromagnetic energy. And these people are called electromagnetic sensitives. And they're literally reaching out with their electromagnetic field and magnetizing that energy, bringing it toward them. And they're kind of plugging in to the electromagnetic debris that they feel everywhere. And they're hypersensitive. And I know how to stop this. We've stopped this with a number of people. It's a new thing we're working with, but it's exciting to see. And one of the things that folks do with the biophoton machine is that they include the biophoton machine into their electromagnetic field. So they're just embracing it. I mean, you love it, right? You're embracing it, and it makes this little wee, wee, wee noises, and you get that, and you're like, oh, this is, and that's you. You're feeling that, and your sensibilities and your intuition is tuning in at every part of you. But the thing is, you don't have to do it that way. Because what that will do is, eventually over time, that'll make you tired. It'll deplete you. Just like if you're walking around with like an x-ray machine attached to your structure. I mean, that'd be a little tough, you know, or your microwave maybe. Wanna bring that? It's not a healthy thing. And we are human biological units, and so we need to protect those biological units from the excess of the 21st century. And how do we do that? And my suggestion is we learn that with education. We learn it. Education and consciousness. And that's how we find our way through. So you've felt that you spent a lot of time and treasure getting good at what you do. Right? You know what to do. I bet any one of you can just give a kick-ass biophoton session. And maybe more, because a lot of you are trained in other modalities. But have you ever considered that the burnout, the merging, and the exhaustion was not about what you did, but how you did it? That there's a distinction. Because very few modalities teach you how to work. They teach you what to do, but how to work. And you can see this in, like, for example, acupuncture. You know, people never get the instruction about putting their own electromagnetic energy into the needle point and setting the needle with their electromagnetic field. People never get the idea implanted in their consciousness that that might not be healthy. They just do it because they're using their own chi. So this brings us to the question of, what's the difference? So the subtle electromagnetic field is here. So this is the electromagnetic field. But the edge of the subtle anatomy is like 15 feet away. Literally the back wall for me. Or even maybe a little further. Way up, way down, all the way out. But how does that work? Good thing, it changes shape. So what it can do, what we can do with it, is we can use it. So I can take my electromagnetic field, I can bring it in, and I can, by placing my awareness at the edge of my subtle anatomy, bringing it in, putting it right on my hands, placing it close to me, I can use that to interface with my machine, my Shirin machine. So I'm at the edge with my Shirin machine, at the edge of my subtle anatomy. I'm not absorbing that energy because consciously I have chosen to treat it with so much respect that I don't want to absorb it. The most respectful thing we can do is to not merge with other people and things and rocks, trees, the planet. What do you think of that idea?
Well, can you address that? What about lovers?
It's one of the worst ways we merge. I mean, it's really, you know, and we have a lot of teachings that show, you've seen the pictures of the chakras open in the heart and like, oh, this is something you want to shoot for. You know, to quote the biophoton machine. No, you do not want to do that. And the reason you don't want to merge with another person is because you want to bring everything you are to that relationship. You want to bring the truth about yourself to that person. And you want to make the offering of your spirit, your soul, your mind, your heart, your body to that person. And you don't want to forget that you are that in relationship to them. That's a mature relationship. Immature relationship is that I don't care, it really doesn't matter. I'll just merge with you because you're bigger than me. You know? I mean, that's
me.
You make me whole. Well, guess what? That's bullshit. And the reason it's bullshit is because wholeness is here. It's not over there somewhere. So if we learn to use this enormous energy field that we all have, and every one of you has it, if we learn to use it, if we train it, if we put it into service of the greater message, which is you too are a powerhouse, wow, look at what happens. Every single healing you do is a life-transforming event. Well, it may already be doing that for a lot of people, but it's just the way you hold it and yourself in relationship to others. So every encounter, instead of becoming an opportunity for merging and losing power, becomes an opportunity for empowerment. It's not just what you're doing for yourself, but what you're doing for every other person you connect with. What do you think of that idea? It's kind of what we're looking for, isn't it? So, okay, so I was born with this ability to see and sense and hear and know, and you know, I had that coming in, and I didn't lose it at about 7, which is when most people kind of lose their thing, you know. And I kept on with it, and so for the last, you know, I'm 65 now, so like my whole life, I have been trying to figure out what the hell it is I'm looking at, because you know my eyes are okay. There's nothing wrong with me. So then there must be something right. So I just analyzed it. And one of the things I discovered was that being a sensitive person and being visually acute, I was able to map the subtle anatomy. So that was a big discovery. But was the bigger discovery was that I was able to teach other people how to use it. That would, for me, that was like, that was the miracle. This isn't the miracle. The miracle is that you can learn it. That's the miracle. So, you know, it's not instantaneous. It doesn't, you know, not everybody can just, yeah, like I got it. You know, it's not like that. It's actually a practice. We call it the edge practice. So I see these energy fields around everything, around rocks and trees and planets and around things. Around everything. And there are ingredients that are in the subtle anatomy that are in everything because everything is energy. Everything is the same, same, same. So even they used to think there was void in space. Now they don't think there's void. Now they actually think it's just energy, which is what I've been saying for about 30 years. So this practice that I developed called the Edge Practice, this has literally saved thousands of people's lives, especially healers. Thousands. I'm serious. It's transformed the way people interact. And this is the first thing that you need to know about it. So I'm going to take you toward the practice. I can't teach you the whole thing because it takes too long to really teach it well, and I don't do it if I can't do it well. But there is a greater awareness within each of you. There is a subtle awareness of the wholeness of all things. Some of you feel this as a kind of emotional truth. Some might feel it as a physical reality. You resonate. Some may feel it as a spiritual actuality. And of course, some feel it really emotionally, feel overwhelmed by the beauty of the skies, the depth of the ocean, and on and on. So when I stopped merging and I stopped constantly getting sick and I started living my life, one of the things that changed was that I stopped being afraid of people. And unfortunately, I found this is often the case with healers, that they're afraid of their clients in some way, that there's a fear element that enters in because it costs to do these sessions, costs us. So if you can begin to understand that your mind, your body, your heart, and your spirit connect with others in a very specific way, you start becoming a light worker, which is really what biophoton practitioners are. You guys, it's a group of healers, but it's really a group of light workers, isn't it? And this interconnection, this interconnectivity that you have with all creation is very tangible. Do you feel this? Yeah, most of us do. So in each aspect of your self-identity is available to you and it speaks to you all the time, but most especially when you're doing healing work. And one of the things that happens for healers is we think that, oh, this is the thing that happens when I'm doing healing work. Like, I have this special, like, sort of sacred chamber that I enter when I'm healing. And I'm healing in my sacred chamber. Or some people, do you guys meditate? Anybody here a meditator? So some of you sit on your cushion, that's your sacred chamber on the cushion. Or, you know, you go see somebody like Amma or some sacred being, and it's a sacred chamber, and you have that experience of connectivity and wholeness. And what I'm suggesting, I'm actually being extremely, badly behaved in certain circumstances, I guess. But what I'm suggesting is you can have it all the time. That it isn't just while you're doing healing work, it isn't just while you're like surrendering to the sacred, it isn't just when you're allowing yourself psychologically to be so attuned and focused that your mind is sharp and quick and, you know, it isn't that. It's all the time, and you can actually live this way. I mean, is that something that intrigues you? Something that you would like to do? Yeah. So then there's the ego, right? The egoic nature, and it might be an interesting approach to the ego to realize that the ego and these more sacred aspects of the mind, body, heart, and spirit, that the ego is actually part of that pantheon, part of that board of directors, if you will, that the ego sits at the table with everybody else. And oftentimes the ego overrules mind, body, heart, spirit and says, I know better, and we of course know. When that's happening, we're usually going down the rabbit hole. But and naturally we can work without becoming fully embodied, right? You know, we can work without becoming completely enlightened. We can do all kinds of good stuff without fulfilling our potential, right? But wouldn't it be great to be going for that? Wouldn't it be incredible? And probably many of you are going for that in your own way. You're working, you're doing your spiritual practice, you're doing what you can to get there. And what I'm telling you is that the sacred anatomy can take your hand and help you. That it will actually get you there faster because it allows you to expand your consciousness and live into your human potential, which is huge. So, let's see. Okay, perfect. So we're going to do an exercise now about becoming present. Because to be present is the most important thing. To be present for your own life, to be present for your own awakening, to be present for all the information that you want to receive from a client. And actually, it's the first step to learning how to go to the edge, becoming present. So I did this, I think, in the last time we were together, but it's never a problem doing it again. So I'd like to invite you to stand up. And what we're going to experience is essentially a descent of spirit. But this is only your spirit. Nobody else's spirit is descending. It's just yours. And it's really a daily practice to do this. And in fact, I suggest people do it multiple times during the day because there are so many opportunities to become not present. Right? Can you think of the last time that happened for you? Like maybe just sitting here during a business meeting? It's hard to stay present for stuff that requires deep focus, right? And it's sometimes hard to stay present when, you know, you're thinking about, I'd really like to have tuna salad for lunch, you know? Or I need to get home, my kids miss me, or something else is always there to distract you. But if you're present in the moment, distractions essentially arise and depart as a kind of floating detritus that kind of moves across the screen of your life. Isn't that interesting? All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to feel into the subtle anatomy, and you're going to do a thing I call telegraphing, which is telling your hands to attract to it the energy that we would call spirit. So one of the things I discovered years ago was that everybody had this orange golden ball that was sort of floating around somewhere in the upper regions of the structure. And it didn't have any real purpose, I could see, except that people who were highly functional, like a decathlete, for example, or Billie Jean King, when she was kicking what that guy, what was his name, Riggs, she's kicking his butt. I thought, she's got that thing in her. What is it? What happened? And it's your presence. It's your essence. Bobby Riggs, that was his name. Remember him? Yeah. Some of us remember,
Five of us remember.
Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to telegraph into the subtle anatomy, and we're going to call to our hands essentially this ball of light. It's a golden orange ball of light. And I'm going to have you say out loud, so put your hands above your head like so, and I'm going to have you say out loud, beloved spirit, please come to my hands.
Beloved spirit, please come to my hands.
I call my essence to me.
I call my essence to me.
So spirit, essence, and presence are all the same thing, you guys. It's all the same. So as you feel it come into your hands, say, I'm so glad to meet you.
I'm so glad to meet you.
I've been waiting a long time to talk to you. And I'm thrilled that you're here with me now. Because I'm so grateful to you. And I'd like to issue an invitation now.
Beloved essence,
I invite you to come into my physical body.
I invite you,
spirit, to embody in me. And then just gently move the ball of light down into your head. Just bring it down to your head. And you know, if you don't feel comfortable, guys, just don't do it. Just watch. It's okay. Into your head. And notice what happens in your head. Just notice how your head feels different. You know, notice the shape and the size, the way it feels, any sensations. And now put your hands on your head, right on your head, and say, I think this is a good idea. Breathe in, beloved presence, please come into my throat.
Beloved presence, please come into my throat.
And you need to say it out loud, and I'll tell you why, because it activates your subtle anatomy. Your voice turns it on. So if nobody else likes your voice, your subtle anatomy loves it. So back in front of your throat, put your hands there. And say, my name is, and then say your name.
My name is.
And then say it again.
My name is Bobby.
And then say your name three times. Desda, 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 just like that. And then say,
My name is.
Thank you. Beloved presence, please come into my chest. And while you're bringing it down, notice how your voice sounds different. Just notice that your voice has a little more resonance, maybe. Placing your hands right on your heart. I love being present.
I love being present.
I love my spirit.
I love my spirit.
I love my essence.
I love my essence.
And I am that.
And I am that.
Breathe in. Beloved presence, please come into my solar plexus.
Beloved presence, please come into my solar plexus.
And then putting one hand on the front, one hand on the back of your solar plexus area. I'm happy to be present.
I'm happy to be present.
It's fun to be present.
It's fun to be present.
Yay!
Yay!
Breathe in. And just relaxing. Now, take another deep breath and say, Beloved Presence, please come down into my pelvis.
Beloved Presence, please come down into my pelvis.
And move it down into your pelvis. And then watch as it just sort of opens up and fills the pelvis. Just opens up and goes from one side over on one hip all the way to the other side and all the way back to the back of your pelvic bowl and down to the pelvic floor, just really filling up that whole area and filling up all of the gut, your bladder, ladies, the uterus, ovaries, guys, all of your bits and pieces, everybody's bits and pieces filled with light. And just place your hand on the back of your, small of your back, a little bit low, right at the coccyx, and then one hand at the front and say, I am present.
I am present.
And now with this awareness, just take a deep breath, lift your arms, and then as you let them down, just allow your presence to zip down your arms, and zip down your legs, and zip into your knees and elbows, your wrists, your ankles, your feet, your hands, your toes, your fingers. And really get that you're coming from this deep presence that's seated in your pelvis. Because your pelvis is the offering bowl. This is where you make your offering in life. This is where you bring it forward. You know, we do that with our guts. We do that with this part of ourselves. These big joints and muscles that enable us to move in the world, to reproduce, to have children. So this is the part of us that continues the species. We must be present there for the species to continue. That's one of the things. But you know what? We must be conscious there for the species to evolve. That's the thing. We must be conscious here for the species to evolve. And that's my whole mission, you know. Let's get this thing going here. So how does that feel to you? Stop and think, like, how are you feeling right now? And is there a part of your body where you couldn't get your presence to go into? You know, like that coccyx, the tailbone that hurts all the time, maybe? Or some other place? So wherever it is that you were unable to be present, take your hand and just put it there right now. Put it wherever you have difficulty being present. And if you're getting tripped up in your head, just put it right here. Like if you're thinking too much, some of you are just really thinking a lot. So if you're thinking a lot, put it here, put your hands here. And then what I want you to do is close your eyes, take a deep breath, and simply be present with everything that that place has to tell you. Everything that it has to say. Everything that it wants to reveal to you. You can be in the place of injury or pain, the more present you can be there, the less pain you have. Just let yourself be present. Because when we hurt, we try to run away from it. We try to get away from it. One of the things that working with your biophoton machines does, and doing the work you do with the cell, is it brings the present. It brings present for people the concept that cells can be whole and healthy if we're awake to them. And if you've ever seen dark field microscope work where the little cells merge and one gives light to the other, we know that there's this natural compassion that we have within ourselves at a cellular level. At any rate, would you just pick somebody to share your experience with? Just somebody near you, quick. Go ahead.
Yeah.
So what was that like for you? You can sit down again if you want. Or you can stay up, it doesn't matter. Either way. Sometimes it's nice to keep sitting. So what was that like for you guys? What happened for you? Just a couple. Yeah?
It was great. It was like when you get connection during meditation, it was like that zing, that energized feeling. It was very significant when I first brought down to my head, and then, of course, brought more clarity and focus to different parts of the body that I could really feel whether I was aligned correctly or whether I had any aches or pains. I could really just kind of align myself.
Right.
Kind of gave me a lens to also
right.
feel. If I had a weird emotion there, maybe if I, you know, I could feel those. Because
yeah. you have little stashes of, right. in your body of places that were holding things that you didn't even know were there.
Right.
Yeah. Yes.
So one of the things I noticed was, so when I try and meditate, it takes me, you know, a few minutes to be able to get there, to shut off the mind chatter.
Oh, yeah.
And when I meditate, I send energy down to my feet and then back up, you know. And I just thought, oh, I'll just try that, and it was just boom, it was just like moving totally, way faster than it would normally, you know. It got there very quickly. That's
what I'm saying. Right. Well, one of the things that's so interesting is people who've done sort of similar exercises, yogic postures or different things, in their life where they do this regularly, when you put this language to it and you suggest that it's your spirit dissenting into your body and that it is an embodiment that's happening, that this is kind of a powerful way to look at it. So it isn't then all about the energies that are somehow coming from somewhere else. It's actually you. Wow, you know, I think that's a wow. The other thing that's so important is that in our cultures, we don't do an initiation or a celebration when children are born. We don't, you know, do what Kunta Kinte's dad did and hold him up to the sun and say, you know, spirit, come into this body. We don't do that. And the thing about your subtle anatomy is it's very polite. It must be invited.
Well, we've actually.
and then we do that test where we stab the kids in their heel. That's going to help. So, you know, there's this sort of lack of awareness around what a sacred event birth is. And, of course, we've worked really hard in the last 40 years with the birth movement to really get people awake to the home birth ideas and water births and all these different births, and people now have, you know, their birth plan and on. But after the baby is born, there's this opportunity too, and I would call that embodiment, conscious embodiment, ensoulment. You know, and there's a need for the being to invite that, or the parent to invite that on behalf of the child. And there's a difference between people who are embodied and people who are disembodied. You know that, right? You see that in your work, I'm sure. Okay. So the descent of spirit, that's called returning presence, the exercise that we just did. Would some of you like to have a copy of that exercise?
Yeah.
Okay, so Bob, would you please pass a paper around, and what we'll do is get your email address, and you will email a copy of the exercise. So if you would like that, we will go ahead and send that to you as a gift. But what if you would like to be on my mailing list, put a check by your name, okay? So I know, or you could just put M for mailing, all right? So without, I won't put you on my mailing list if I don't see that invitation, because I believe invitations are important. All right, so at this point, a number of biophoton practitioners have taken the EDGE class, or what I call the Illuminated Body for Professional Healers, and the next time I'm teaching it is May, right, Bobby? Yeah.
Date.
What's the date, Meg? He knows.
Momentarily.
I know other stuff. He knows that. I'll give it to you in a second. So, we have on that weekend in May, I believe, still got
it's the 14th and 15th.
And I'm not teaching hygiene that week.
No, the 14th and 15th of May.
Yeah. So, along with learning the technique, you also get a booklet that has in it the five steps that are necessary for learning how to go to the edge, and you can have this forever, keep it. You can read it over and over again. Some people take the class 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 times. People take it over and over again because they love it. It's first of all, fun, but they learn from it. So I will pass this around. People can flip through it if you want. Then after that, I teach another class I want to tell you about called Energetic Hygiene for Healers. I'd urge you to take this class also. You can sign up for both of them together in one weekend, a 1 4-day weekend. This first class is 2 days. This is 2 days also. The reason that's 2 days is because we learn how to do it the first day, and then we actually do it the second day. So when you leave, you have some level of competency, so you can repeat it. You can do it on your own in your practice. And the people that are invited to be in this class are all healers. I try to weed out sightseers and seekers, who are lovely people. But we really need to focus on the canaries in the coal mine, and that is you guys. So hygiene, you learn how to clear yourself, how to bring in specific energies, which augment the Shirin tremendously. We also teach in this class a new wrinkle, very much encouraged by my friend Jane over here, my friend Jen over here, and Tamara Fellow is another buddy, but they have really encouraged me to include in this class how to seal your electronic equipment. So how to tell your electronic equipment to stay inside itself and not grab you and throw you on the floor and harm you in any way. So I'm going to be teaching that in this class also. I'll pass this around if you want to look at that book. Then after that, I have more advanced trainings for healing professionals. I have an energy medicine class that I'm teaching. I didn't even teach it last year. It's available this year, called CI Medicine Bay. And it's 2 3-day weekends and evenings as well. And it's a really intense energy medicine class. There are 2 booklets for that. If you're interested, you're welcome to look at them.
Can you tell us where the classes take place?
Right now, I'm teaching these 2 beginning classes at a facility in Sebastopol, which is north of here. I used to travel all over the world and teach, and it's too exhausting, and I don't like sleeping in other people's beds, and so that's it. I just teach it. I'm 65, for God's sake. So, but I'll tell you what, you know, if anybody managed to get 25 people together, I'd probably do it. I'd probably go. I'm fortunately training people. What?
Hawaii?
Yeah, I'd go to Hawaii, sure.
Got a good bed.
Is there a decent bed? Last time I was in Hawaii, I had a good bed. I like that. But Hawaii I love, and you know, I go to the UK, and I'm actually going to be teaching this class in Montreal, Canada, and I'm going to Spain, because I want to go to those places. But I really don't want to go back to Kansas. Okay, so this is the practitioner training. And I'm doing one this year. I didn't do one last year. So I'm doing a prac training, and it's 4 4-day weekends. Starts in July, ends in December. You need all the other classes as prerequisites. So that's the way it works. Hey, Tamar. It's good to see you. So they build one upon the other. And then I taught this class last year, Awakening the Nine Levels of Sensing. It's a six-day intensive. You just have to have gone through Illuminated and Hygiene to get into this class. But I have a new one I'm teaching this year. It's called 13 Gateways to the Soul. And it's basically using the chakra system, the 13 chakras, as gateways to enter into the deep connection. And it's all experiential. It's like 6 days of dancing and art and movement and meditation and prayer and laughing and really good food and meditation retreat site with no electronics. Yay! So that's what I'm offering. And I would be interested in doing a illuminated body for biophoton practitioners if I could get enough of you to commit to it. I need a minimum of 10 people. So if I had 10 of you who would say yes to that opportunity, I would just schedule one for you and do it at a different date than the ones that I have. But you can just come into the ones that are already set up. So
That's the first class?
Illuminated. That's the first class. So anybody got questions for me? I'd love to answer questions. You've been so polite.
So how long are those days?
How long are those days?
Yes.
Saturday, there are a Saturday and a Sunday if it's just a weekend. And it starts at 10 and ends at 4. Yeah, and there's an hour for lunch. And there are two breaks that are generally 10 to 15 minutes. So it's an intensive, but it's also human. We can get the information across that way. It's fine. And then if you do all 4 days in a row, it's 10 to 4 each day. You don't do anything at night. Occasionally we have a kind of a gathering one of the nights if we're doing a 4 day and we feel like it, but it's not part of the class by any means. And then if you're local, I have ongoing practice parties that are free. And people come to my house and we practice the edge and practice healing techniques. So I wanted to ask if any of the folks who have taken my classes, either Jane or Jen, would like to share about their experience of learning to go to the edge on the electromagnetic field, how knowing about that changed your lives. And or Tamar or Dennis, I think you've all taken the class.
Well, I can share an experience that we had last night. Carol was measuring me, and my points started dropping, and it's like, oh, and I don't think that's me. And I said, well, wait a second, I think we're merging. And I pulled back my electromagnetic field, and Carol could remeasure, and my points weren't dropping anymore.
Ooh!
So it's that powerful. I mean, Carol witnessed it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I like that.
But were Carol's points all dropping?
No, she was measuring me.
Yeah.
We don't know.
That's cool. Thanks. Gives me some ideas. Because we're in the process of creating scientific studies for this work. We're putting that all together. Any other questions? Or you want to make a contribution, Jane?
Well, I was just going to say a couple of weeks ago I was invited to come to a lot of people who are electrically sensitive, and I thought, well, I'll just do a demonstration of the shrine. Mm-hmm. But if there's something about sort of being in the zone or whatever it is, you know, like being at the edge. And all of a sudden, I had done 4 in a row, and I hardly even knew it. And it was like, and I was still excited, and I still was a full moon, and I went and got spring water, and I drove home, and I was still, you know, feeling real good. It's amazing when you can get in that. And then and the things with the shrine, and everyone was getting the shrine, it's like, well, how can this be? This is too incredible. I'm going, secret ingredient.
So you use the edge and controlling the electromagnetic field.
Exactly, and without thinking, because it was just like one after the other.
Well, you've been really working at this.
Yeah.
She's been a very impressive student.
Well, it's been helping my,
probably all of us,
my sensitivity too.
Oh, that's marvelous. All right. Well, if there's, is there any other question? Yeah.
You mentioned that you've spoken to Kaiser and I think Stanford.
Yeah.
I'm just curious as to how you present your work to them.
Very much the way I presented it to you. When I spoke at University of California, San Francisco Medical School, I talked to 90 students of medicine, pharmacology, and folks who were learning how to be technicians as well. So it was a big group, and I did several of those running. So it was like by the time I was done, I talked to like 150 med students. And they were thrilled by it. So I taught them the returning presence, just like I taught you guys. And then I taught them another technique called witnessing, because I think it's the big missing piece for most docs. They forget to witness their clients, their patients. They forget, you know, that there's somebody else sitting there, another human being. They just think it's a kidney. So I taught them that, and they went away profoundly moved. But I've spoken at international conferences to scientists, you know, I've talked to all kinds of people, and everyone agrees across the board that when you're present, you do better work. You know, they don't know why, really. I'm telling them what I think, but they don't know why, so they're going to have to figure that out on their own. Yeah?
I work at a wellness center in Walnut Creek. I just wanted to mention that we do have a space if you ever wanted to come to the Bay Area and have a conference for this group. Or,
well, I live in Nevada.
Oh.
So I'm here.
Oh, okay.
So let's talk, and why don't you give us your contact information, okay. And, you know, we can speak about, because I don't have a good place in the East Bay to meet with people.
Oh, okay. No, so that would be a big great. Yoga room.
Because I do talks. I do regular teachings. I teach sacred anatomy twice a month for like $15. Oops, 20 at night, 15 during the day.
Okay, I'll give you my information.
Yeah, you know. So if you want to just come to those kinds of classes, it's like it's a book support group, because this is, you know, not only does it take like a forklift to lift it, but, you know, and if you fall asleep while reading it, you could do serious damage to your face when you fall asleep. But it actually is a hard book to read, because it's really dense, you know, if you've tried to read it, it's dense. It's like a lot of the Tibetan writings, it's very dense. So support groups for that book are good.
You ever come back to the East Coast?
I do. I mean, I'm going to go to Montreal, so I'll be very close to the East Coast. And I would, you know, I'd be open to doing something on the East Coast. But at the moment, I'm not interested in making it happen on the East Coast. It's too far. You know, I've done that. I've done things across the world, and it's hard. It's just hard,
much,
you know.
How much of the classes are in the book?
How much of the...
In other words,
nothing.
For me to make the journey out here on a regular basis,
not
nothing's
in the
there
book.
That's in the class.
Not in the book. I am, however, writing a book right now that is almost finished, and the title of that book is Your Subtle Self, How to Be Present for Your Own Enlightenment. And that book is essentially about the edge concept. So when I get that out there, I imagine, and it's written with a lighthearted, fun, you know, short, it's the, you know, 175, 225 page book. So it won't be quite such a... This is a research book. You know, this is like an educational book. Just put it on the shelf. When I want to know more about chakras, pull it out. You know, that kind of thing.
Okay.
But as far as, you know, you should get it. Definitely. I have four of them for sale here today if you want. Yeah.
It's also on Kindle.
And it's on Kindle.
You can lightly carry that.
You can indeed. You can lightly carry it. So, if there are no further questions, I've been allotted 1 hour, and I am at I'm at 1 hour now. So I will yield the floor to the wonderful Hakan. You put this whole thing together?
No,
with my wife. Thank you for coming out and talking with us, and
yes. This
is very needed information, especially for us practitioners and healers.
I think it is, and the other thing I think is that biophoton and core individuation, my work, are like, they're kind of like, really, kind of in love with each other. I mean, it's just amazing when you do the two of them together, because biophoton really addresses the electromagnetic field of the physical body very aggressively. My work addresses the entire structure, so it kind of fills in the blanks. So,
very important, much needed.
Check it out.
Little awareness.
So great meeting you all, and did the paper go around for people to sign up on?
I think yes.
You've got it? Okay, good.
Well, somewhere.
And I look forward to seeing you soon. Some of you got my books, so I'll get those back from you.
Thank you, Desda.
Thank you.
I met Desda last year, and I took her illuminated body and energetic hygiene classes for healers, for professional healers.